Hi, everybody. I'm Greg Fox with Wesch 2 News and Wesch.com, and this is another in our series of debates leading up to the November general election. And right now we're joined by the candidates in House District 30, covering parts of Orange and Seminole counties. The district includes Maitland, Altamont Springs, Eatonville, and areas near Bear Lake and Lake Howell. And the candidates are Democrat and incumbent Joy Goff Marcil and Republican Bob Cortez. Thank you both for joining us and sharing your views so that voters can make an informed choice in the weeks ahead. I'm going to give each of you a minute to open up and tell us a little bit about your personal and professional background. And Ms. Goff Marcil, we will begin with you.
Hi, yes, I'm Joy Goff Marcil, and I proudly represent Florida House District 30. I was born and raised in this district, and I chose to raise our three children here. I served on the Maitland City Council for two terms, and I watched how our state government was increasingly taking away our local decisions. I'm a big supporter of public education, and I'm a big supporter of small business. My husband and I both own a small business. I ran because of the environment. I do not think our state government is supporting our natural resources and protecting our water enough. I'm a Moms Demand Action candidate. I believe in sensible laws, gun safety legislation. I, as a legislator, have been dealing with the failed unemployment system that our current leadership that we've had for 20 years put into place. And I also, before the pandemic, would have voted for expanding Medicaid, and our leadership has refused to take up that issue, that value issue that would have brought jobs and saved all sorts of money. Thank you so much for letting me participate today.
All right, Mr. Cortez, 1 minute, please.
Thank you, Greg, and thank you, Wesch, for hosting this debate. It's important for our voters to have a choice and see what the choices are. My name is Bob Cortez. I am a former commissioner and mayor for the city of Longwood. I also believe in home rule because I did come from local government. And my first stint in public service was a homeowner association president. I did serve in the Florida House from 14 to 18 in this seat, House District 30. But my greatest accomplishments are being a husband to my wife, Virginia, for 36 years, father of four children, grandfather to five, with two on the way. I'm blessed to have such a wonderful family and be a family man. Was born in Brooklyn. I grew up in Puerto Rico. I've lived here in Central Florida for 31 years right now. Small business owner, I've owned two businesses, successful businesses here in Central Florida. And I've also been in public service. And being able to live the life of dual cultures, having both my American background and my Hispanic background. And this district is very diverse, with about a quarter of the population coming from Hispanic background and others. And you mentioned Eatonville, you've got the African American community and the Anglo community. So was and am a public servant and an effective legislator. And I'm honored and proud to serve, and I'm honored to be here today. Thank you.
All right, I'm going to kind of go off the script here a second, because Joy Goff Marcil, you mentioned something in your opening statement, and I want to address that before we move on. You said that you were in favor of Medicaid expansion before the pandemic. Are you not in favor of it now because of the financial bind and the budget hole that we're looking at going into next year and probably the following 2 years as well?
No, I'm absolutely still in favor of it. This expanding Medicaid, we would get a lot of help from the federal government. And it's proven to have worked in other states, where it keeps people out of the emergency rooms and it brings jobs. It's a big money saver. There's no reason why we shouldn't have done it before the pandemic. And I didn't mean to mislead you with that, because what I meant by that was, because of the pandemic, it has intensified the fact that we should have expanded Medicaid. So any opportunity we have to expand Medicaid, I would be for that.
Okay, and as we heard from the budget chiefs last week, Bob Cortez, we are looking at a big budget hole. What does that say to you, and about what support you would or would not provide if you're sent to Tallahassee on Medicaid expansion?
Well, and what's one of the reasons I actually decided to run for this seat again? It is no secret that I lost a seat in 2018 to the incumbent that is right now. And many asked whether I was and was not going to come into public service. And originally I was not, but COVID happened in March, and just the need of what's going to happen in the next legislative session, including a depleted budget, is going to be very challenging. You're going to need very effective legislation. You're going to need experience. You're going to need somebody who's going to be able to get on the ground and knows the ins and outs of budgets to be able to balance a good budget. When I first came in, it was about $69 million. When I left, it was in the mid-80s. And here we are at a $92 billion budget, which we know is we've already been dipping into our reserves. And for the matter of expanding Medicaid, you know, it has shown that it does not improve outcomes in the places that has expanded. And we're talking about, where's the money going to come? The federal government's going to put a portion, but after 3 years, the state government has to pay their portion. And right now, we don't have any funding for that. The biggest chunk of our budget is coming from healthcare. Now, I will say this. I am in favor of looking for waivers from Medicaid to expand for mental health and substance abuse. Opioid abuse is a big problem in our state, and the pandemic has shown the problems that we're having with mental health, and we can use some help in that.
All right. So just to clarify, without those exceptions, you would be a no vote on Medicaid expansion. Is that right?
That's correct.
Okay. Thank you. All right. We're going to move on. Mr. Cortez, as you point out, this is a rematch of sorts. You lost the seat a couple of years ago. Talk to the voters of District 30, maybe in this case, talk to the independent voters in District 30, and explain why you think you're better prepared this time around to be the choice to go to Tallahassee.
Well, you can just look at my record and compare it to hers. In my 4 years serving in the Florida legislature, I passed 21 bills, 17 of them in a bipartisan manner. One of the ones I'm most proud of, House Bill 625, was with then Senator Geraldine Thompson, where we amended the Civil Rights Act, where we protected pregnant women from being discriminated in the workplace. And that was a signature piece of legislation that we did. And most of the bills were passed in a bipartisan manner, which shows that I can work on both sides of the aisle to get things done. I do have the support of the current leadership and of the governor to get things done. I was able to pass also appropriation project, $25 million for Samoa State College for the Student Services Center, which currently is being used today. And then the definition of effective legislature is also blocking bad legislation. In 2018, I was able to block in House Bill 21 the tree trimming regulation that came forward that would have been detrimental to local government. I heard from the city of Altamont Springs, Maitland, and Winter Park about how bad it would be. We went and we talked to the sponsor, and we talked to the staff, and we were able to modify where that bill eventually died. Unfortunately, I was not there in 2019 when this bill came back in 1159, and my opponent was there. The bill did pass and it became law, and now we see the problems of the same thing that I was just talking about.
All right, there's a lot there to address. Ms. Goff-Marcil, go ahead.
Yes, a lot to address on that. I might need to just let everyone know, first of all, how it works up in Tallahassee. The Republican-controlled legislature decides every single piece of legislature that is going to be in front of us. So to say that everything was a big part of it was bipartisan doesn't really mean much, because the Republicans vote yes for everything. And I don't think that Representative Cortez, when he was representative, voted 98% of the time with his party. And as far as the tree trimming bill, it's interesting that he brought that one up, because that was a big reason why I decided to run for office. There was many bills that the legislature, the Republican-controlled legislature, kept throwing at our city council. And that was a really big one because of Maitland and Winter Park and Altamont Springs and how much they appreciate their tree canopies. So I was fighting for that, but there was the way it works too, is it takes a few years for really bad legislation to get through. We keep fighting it. And I also think it's interesting that former Representative Cortez said that he blocked a bill, because that's what I have to do. If I have to vote no on all the bad legislation, I'm very proud of all of my no votes And to me, that's being effective, keeping really bad laws from being passed.
All right, I want to continue talking about some of the bills, Ms. Goff-Marcil. I've been going through some of the nearly three dozen bills you co-sponsored this year. Two of them became law, helping veterans with higher education and making sure graduates in healthcare are not restricted from obtaining or renewing their licenses just because they are student loans. Strong bipartisan support. As a Democrat, how can you make headway if the legislature continues to be run by the Republican Party? Where are you prepared to make compromise and work across the aisle?
Well, the thing is, there are a lot of bipartisan bills, and you refer to a couple of amazingly good bipartisan bills. And like I said, the Republicans decide when those bills get on the floor, and the Democrats are going to vote for good bills. We, in fact, a lot of times a Democrat will have a good idea and the Republican will take that idea and run with that bill. And the Democrats can't do anything about that, but they're fine because they want good legislation to pass. We want to support good legislation. So we vote for good legislation. It's the bad bills that we vote no on.
Mr. Cortez, maybe you could give me an example of some bills that you voted for that were not exceptionally popular among other members of your party, but you felt strongly about. Can you be specific about that?
Well, yeah, we had a bill in 2018 that actually I voted against. That was not in favor of what the party wanted. It was the growth management bill that would have moved the boundaries over by UCF. And we're talking about the rural boundary that exists in Seminole County. That growth management bill had an amendment that was put in there. I voted against that bill because I knew that it was detrimental. I also voted against a bill, House Bill 7099, back in 2015, that would have decimated our tourist development in Texas here in Central Florida. It was a bill that was sponsored by Chairman Matt Gaetz, and the leadership wanted this bill passed. It was a leadership bill, but because it was detrimental to our tourist development in Texas here in Central Florida, I voted against it.
All right. Mr. Cortez, we'll stick with you. In 2016, you were a yes vote in the House for Bill 191 to authorize fracking, the controversial practice of injecting high-pressure liquid into the ground to extract oil and gas. Can you explain your vote, and if given the chance, would it be a no vote this time?
Absolutely. That was one of my first years in learning the process. We were told and given some science and data, and it was actually to promote some studies for that is what it was going for. I did vote for that, yes. And then after that, every single year fracking came up, I voted against it. Once we got educated on the process of fracking, I voted against fracking. I still am opposed to fracking right now.
Ms. Goff-Marcil, on fracking, and you mentioned in, I believe, your opening statement talking about, and we can get into this and back to Mr. Cortez as well, where exactly have you worked and will work when it comes to protecting our natural resources here in the state of Florida?
Well, one way I worked on it is to vote against bills that were not good for our environment. And I want to just go back to the fracking a little bit, because in my research, Mr. Cortez voted for fracking and he voted against all the amendments that the Democrats put forth that were trying to keep the chemicals out of the water, and were trying to give transparency and letting people know that the chemicals were in the water. And it was just a whole series of amendments that he voted against. And I'm confused why, I don't know if it even came up after that. So it's not in my research, because then when I was in the state house, we didn't have a fracking bill, thank goodness. I'm also very supportive of some of the bills that my Republican colleagues have been trying to get through to get rid of septic tanks and figure out a way to do that in a way that is affordable to the citizens. And that would be a great way to reduce the phosphorus in our water and clean up our waterways. Because we all can agree, this is a very bipartisan issue, and the fact that we can all agree that we need to drink clean water. It's just that the Republican leadership is not doing enough to get that to be a reality and make it sustainable.
I'm going to give Mr. Cortez 45 seconds to respond to some of your earlier comments, Ms. Goff-Marcil. Go ahead, Mr. Cortez.
So, yeah, like I said, in my first year under fracking, I don't deny what we vote and the votes that I took. But after that, every single time we voted against fracking, and I've been publicly since then saying I don't support fracking whatsoever, and I still don't. And, you know, to her point that she says that she's a co-sponsored bill and the Republican leadership blocks everything, all the bills that she's put forward, unfortunately, are not bills that the Republican leadership or anybody else wouldn't really support. Darren Soto, I served with him, and he was a very effective legislator who was a Democrat because he was able to find a way to work with Republicans and Democrats and pass good legislation to the point that today he's a congressman serving in the U.S. Congress doing just exactly that. I believe that in order to be an effective legislator, you've got to find your own way, make your own path, not co-sponsor bills from somebody else just to try to take credit for it.
I'm going to go off script because, again, Ms. Goff-Marcil, you brought up something interesting. Septic to sewer, a number of the studies, in fact, another House district that we've dealt with here in a debate, House district out in Brevard County, a number of those bills were vetoed by our Republican governor, Ron DeSantis, for studies to look at septic to sewer. I guess people hear about these bills more frequently now, and I guess the big question is, how do you pay for any of this? So we'll start with Ms. Goff-Marcil. As you mentioned, there is an expense, and the fear that a lot of people have is how much of it they're going to have to bear to get to a sewer system as opposed to septic right now. So where does that money come from?
Well, and this is an additionally difficult question to answer now with COVID-19, because we were having apparently a difficult time trying to come up with the money before. And one of the ways that it can be done is by taking out the low interest loan, the bonds that the cities would take. And if there could be ways to charge it on the homeowner where it's very affordable and it's shared with the government. But like I said, I'm not sure that this is going to be as pressing of an issue until we can get through this pandemic. Because right now we need to focus, our economy is not going to grow, it's not going to open fully until we can get a hold of the pandemic, which is directly related to the economy. We have to get widespread testing in place and contact tracing so we know where the outbreaks are and everyone feels comfortable doing all the wonderful things we were doing before this pandemic.
Mr. Cortez, septic to sewer, how do you pay for it? And maybe was that the subject of some of the bills when you were in the legislature?
Well, before, and this comes from local government, because Longwood, most part of Longwood is still under septic. The problem that you have is that before you can even go septic to sewer, you got to make sure that the local government does have a sewer system that is viable that can handle the extra load. And if they don't, you know, the additional cost and expense of either the city or county of creating that, if they don't have a good sewer system where to send the waste to, then there's no way that you can make the homeowners do the switch. That's one of the things. And then at the end of the day, what happens to the homeowners? They just invested tens of thousands into a new septic system. And then he's forced to go into a sewer system and connect to the system. What happens to all the expense? I believe that there's a way to do like we did in Longwood. It's a long-term plan that we can gradually move into that with a good planning and move folks into a good, viable sewer system that can be long-term and it's not a burden on homeowners.
We've touched on some different areas involving the pandemic. One of them, of course, the now 3.6 million plus jobless claims that have been processed in the state of Florida. Initially, those claims couldn't be filled because of the computer system that failed. What do you think should be done, Mr. Cortez, to fix that? And I want to be specific here. Would you vote to restore the 26 weeks of benefits from the current 12 and to raise the maximum benefit from $275? And if so, to what amount?
Absolutely, yes. I would vote to restore the 26, especially in emergency situations. And as far as the price go, how much it would go from 275? First of all, we're doing 275 that was dealt with back in 2011. Even cost of living alone, it costs more than that. How much could that be? I think the economist can tell us what would be a good number that would help the worker, and it's something that the state can afford. So definitely, I am for doing that. And also, we can look into the contracts we're building out. We had a $70, $80 million contract. Then we gave another $100-something million contract to this vendor who gave us a failed system, a system that could not handle the load. We need to hold our contractors and our vendors accountable when we're doing these contracts. And then what's even crazy is that after all that, they gave them a contract with the Department of Health worth another $135 million. That we need to clamp down on.
All right. And just for those people who are not up to speed on this, so what you were saying, Mr. Cortez, is that after Deloitte was called on the carpet for the existing system, then they were given an Agency for Healthcare Administration additional contract, which apparently cannot be rescinded. Ms. Goff-Marcil, and before I move on, what should the weekly amount be, Mr. Cortez? 500? 400?
It is what's commensurate to what the state will be able to afford. And here's one thing. If the amount is going to be $400 or $500, whatever the amount's going to be, also try to build in some cost of living, because eventually we're going to find ourselves having to revisit this several years from now.
Okay, but again, we're the third largest state and we're in the bottom two or three in weekly benefits. Should it be double what it is?
I know it can't be 275. If the right amount is $500, then that's what, and we can afford it, that's what it should be.
All right, so we don't have an amount for Mr. Cortez. Ms. Goff-Marcil on the unemployment system.
Yes, well, this is very interesting that Mr. Cortez is saying that he is upset with the contract, because I am perplexed that our Republican leadership signed another contract with this company that was under investigation for doing such a terrible job on unemployment. And as far as the amount, I would want it to be commensurate with whatever other states that are doing it in a good job, good way. We were comparing ourselves to other states before, and they were processing claims months before us. My office has helped over 400 constituents with their claims, and we're still getting calls. Just this last week, we've had a couple people that haven't gotten any payments since April. So this is a failed system. It was designed to fail. Our governor even admitted that. Our former governor admitted that. And I'm just confused why my opponent is now saying that he's against his party on this whole unemployment system.
Okay, so I didn't hear the answer to two of those questions. Ms. Goff-Marcil, what should the weekly amount be? I'll give you a chance in a second, Mr. Cortez. So should the benefits be raised back to 26 weeks, and what should the weekly amount be?
Yes, absolutely. I thought I answered that because I said it should be an amount that is commensurate with other states that are doing it at the top level. And I'm not off the top of my head knowing what those other states are. You need to look at the cost of living and whether this is something that people can survive on, because right now people can't survive on the Florida amount. The only reason they were able to survive is because they were getting the federal benefits.
And the weekly amount, what should it be? Give me a number here.
I have to give you a number, even though I don't have the economic still. So I want it to be a number that is like the states that are performing well and that are giving people enough money for them to pay their bills and not be put out on the street.
Okay. Mr. Cortez, I'll give you 30 seconds to respond to some of her comments earlier on, and then we're going to move on.
Well, she mentions the Republican leadership. Of course, that was not the legislature that signed those contracts. It was the agency that did so. And if she wants to go down that route, that contract that was just given to Deloitte was under her leadership. I was not in there. So if you want to put the blame on somebody in the legislature, you were there, not me. So I believe that it was a bad contract, and we can both agree that this is something that needs to be fixed.
All right, Ms. Goff-Marcil, I'm going to give you 30 seconds. Go ahead.
Please, let me respond to that. I'm not sure what he's talking about. The Deloitte contract was signed back in years and years ago when the unemployment system was set up. And this new one, I have nothing to do with that. And even if your leadership is the one who had to do with it. And you vote with them 98% of the time. So if you were there.
You keep on throwing the leadership and you have to take responsibility for part of this. You know, this is why we can't get things done. We need to work together instead of tossing blame on everybody else. This happens in Washington and it happens here in Florida. Instead of blaming everybody else, why don't we roll our sleeves and work together?
I would be happy to work together, but you are part of the leadership. You are part of the problem. And now you are telling me something that you vote differently than what you say. You say one thing, you tell the voters one thing, and then you get up there and you vote the opposite. It's very easy to just look at your record.
Look at my record,
and yes, it speaks for itself.
Mm-hmm. All right, I think that we're going to agree to disagree at this juncture. I'm going to ask you one more quick question, and I'd like you to keep your answer to 30 seconds or less. Our Republican governor, Ron DeSantis, has been both lauded and criticized, depending on who you ask, on how he's handled the coronavirus pandemic, the reopening of the economy, especially as it pertains to the second wave when we reopened bars in June, had to close them. Now they're back open again. Mr. Cortez, 30 seconds. How would you grade the governor's performance on protecting us and keeping our economy going during coronavirus?
Well, you got to understand that nobody expected us to go through a pandemic, and there was no manual how to deal with a pandemic. That's one of the first things we need to do is create policies on how to deal with an emergency situation like this. He was working off the cuff. He was working on what they were telling him to do. Some things worked, some things did not work, but here we are dealing with it. Other states had the same issues. They shut down completely and their economy has gone tank. So to criticize for the governor for something that nobody really knew how to do it or how to get it right, I think irresponsible. I think we need to work on getting new policies in the future to make sure if this ever happens again, we're ready.
Ms. Goff-Marcil, on grading the governor on coronavirus.
I'm going to give him an F. I do agree that it was not the Republicans' fault that we have this pandemic. And I agree that it was a new thing that none of us had ever experienced before, but we had evidence from other countries. We knew what we should do. Our governor did not encourage wearing masks. He was taking directions from our president. It's incredible that how bad the response was. And now he forced the schools to open. He forced them, even though they were pleading to not have to open. And I, being in Orange County, I haven't gotten the Seminole County numbers yet, but as of last week, 61 of our 202 public schools had cases in them. And who knows what's going to happen now, because we still don't have the testing. We still don't have the contact tracing that we need to keep this virus under control. And like I said before, until we do, we will not be able to open this economy and get us back on track.
All right, we're going to move into closing statements. I'll give you each a minute. We'll begin with Mr. Cortez.
And thank you, Greg, once again, for your professionalism, and thank you for hosting these debates to, again, give the voters a choice in the view and what to do with it. And Wesh, also, for being gracious in doing this. It's important for the voters in November to see what they've got and make a choice. And that's what this is all about. This is about not about Goff-Marcil, myself, the representative, or the governor of the state. This is about our constitutional right to vote and voters having a choice. I want to thank Representative Goff-Marcil for the spirited debate and being able to discuss and talk about this and wish her and her family safety in these tough and troubling times. And we got challenges ahead. We've got our budget that is going to be, like you said, in a tough situation. We've got to balance it. We still have COVID looming around it. It's not going to go away. They say parts of the economy is not going to reopen for another 3 years. Our tourism is suffering. And a lot of our other industries here in the state of Florida, we need to make sure that we create policies to fix that. Education, like Goff-Marcil said, We've got challenges in education, but we're seeing advances in technology, virtual and other type of hybrid models that we need to make sure we can continue to expand, because at the end of the day, our students do have to continue education. Jobs and the environment. We're talking about right now shoring up our shores. We need to make sure our shores have been shored up. You know, we're seeing seven hurricanes out in the Atlantic and the Gulf of Mexico. It's going to raise our water. This is the new normal. In healthcare, opioid epidemic, mental health, and everything else. A lot of challenges. I ask people to just check me out. Go to my website, www.bobcortez.com. We need effective leadership, one that has the support of our leadership and of the governor. And with that, I am humbly asking for your vote and your support. My name is Bob Cortez, and I'm asking for your vote. Thank you.
All right. That was more like a minute and a half to 2 minutes. Ms. Goff-Marcil, go ahead. Equal time.
Thank you. Thank you to WESH TV for hosting, and thank you to my opponent for joining us today. It has been my pleasure to serve as in this hometown district these last 2 years. As your hometown candidate, I want to continue to fight what is most important in our community, which is healthcare, public education, and the environment, all of which is tied up in our economy. My opponent will say he is for the same things, but his voting records will show otherwise. He will say that he's bipartisan, but his votes with his party are with 98% of the time, and he votes with them on some really bad laws. It is important to have people fighting against bad laws, and I have been effective at fighting that bad legislation. I've also worked on the other side as well. I was actually sponsoring the bill that you referred to before of the healthcare workers being able to continue their licenses even if they didn't pay their student loans. And I had a Democratic colleague who also had a similar bill. So I dropped out of that bill. And then I picked up a bill that the Republicans were wanting to pass, which was a bill regarding human trafficking. And I very strongly supported that. So I was willing to sponsor that bill. So I want to fight to bring our economy back. But as I said, and I keep repeating, we have to get control of this virus, and we have to do it in a strong way. I will continue to listen to my constituents. Before the pandemic, I traveled the district hosting town halls, including an education town hall, to talk to public education leaders and parents and support staff and educators. And since the pandemic, I've held 23 weekly virtual town halls for my constituents. I have these town halls every Wednesday at 1 p.m. on Zoom. So please join me. And also you can check out my website at joy4fl.com. I hope you will vote to keep Joy in the House. Thank you.
All right, thank you very much. These are the candidates in House District 30, which covers parts of Seminole and Orange County. Democrat Joy Goff-Marcil, Republican Bob Cortez, thank you for joining us very much. And this has been a WESH 2 News and WESH.com debate. I'm Greg Fox.